Hello everyone, I'm Sean from WEX, and I'm going to be telling you about the new Canon C70. We at WEX are thinking of it as the successor to the C100, which has been with us for the best part of a decade now, so we're due an upgrade. But not only that, but the C70 will also be the smallest Cinema EOS camera ever rolled out by Canon. Similar to the C300 Mark III, the C70 will also don the dual gain output Super 35 4K sensor. So the way the dual gain output element of the sensor works is that it basically samples every pixel that it sees twice, one of them prioritizing the saturation levels and the other prioritizing the noise levels. And then what it does is it combines those two sampled versions of the same shot together, enabling low noise HDR video. And the mount used to fit lenses against this sensor is the RF mount, meaning that all the native lenses will be the new RF range produced by Canon. For all of you who have been collecting EF lenses over the years, Canon are also rolling out a line of adapters, which will be RF to EF converters, so you don't need to worry about not being able to use all your lenses. And one of those adapters that we'll be releasing alongside this camera will be a 0.71x speed booster, and that will basically boost this straight up to the equivalent of a full frame. And even though this is a small bodied camera, we still benefit from internal ND filters, and we get up to 10 stops of ND filters on the extension mode. So shooting outdoors in any environment should be bliss. This is like a similar size. You could compare it, I guess, to the 1DX Mark III, but this is slightly smaller, which is really impressive. Now, in terms of picture quality and resolutions, all of the resolution sizes shoot in 10-bit 422, and you have the choice of shooting either in XF AVC or in MP4. In terms of resolutions, starting at the top, we have 4K DCI, so that's Cine 4K, the full whack. And then beneath that, we have Ultra HD 4K. A little bit lower than that, we have 2K, and then we have full HD, and then we have 720p HD. So you pretty much have the full range of all the resolution sizes that you could expect from a cinema camera for basically just catering to any job that you'd like. As far as the frame rates go, 4K DCI in all intra goes up to 30p recording speed. The same goes for UHD, but then when we go down to full HD and 720p, then you get 50p recording. However, if you choose to shoot in the long GOP format, that's 50p across both of your 4K resolutions. And one of my favorite features across many cameras is the fact that this has a S&F, which stands for slow and fast motion. Not so much in the fast motion department in this camera, it only goes as fast as 15 frames per second really, so not really useful for time lapses. We're only talking like double the speed as opposed to like 25 times the speed. However, the slow motion, in 4K DCI you can go up to 120p slow motion, which is brilliant. But if that's not quite enough and you want a little bit more from your slow motion, then if you knock it down to 2K or full HD, whichever you prefer, you can then go up to 180 frames per second slow motion. And something that's optional, because most of the time if you're shooting in a S&Q or S&F slow motion mode, the camera doesn't record the sound along with it. But something that is quite thoughtful of Canon to put into the Canon C70 is that you can set it so that you're shooting in slow and fast motion, but you can also record the audio with it. Now, it won't be baked into the video clip that this camera would then output. It would record a separate audio file to go alongside it, which you could apply later. And this audio file is recorded in real time, so to play back, it would just be at normal speed. Picture profiles. So you can just shoot in 709 if you want to, with all the colors baked straight into your footage there. But if you're someone who likes to get a wider dynamic range or have a little bit more control over the colors when it comes to your edit, then you do have a choice between C-Log2 and you also get C-Log3. And then with the additions of HLG and PQ, which I'm not too familiar with personally in terms of usage, but I'm sure there are professionals out there who know how to implement these picture profiles. In all honesty, I think most people will be choosing to shoot C-Log2 or even C-Log3 for the more cinematic shooters. It entirely depends on your shooting situations and what your preferences are. And built into the handle grip, we have a little hatch that opens up, and there we have dual card slots for SDXC cards. And what's really good about this camera is that you can record to both cards at the same time. And I know that's nothing particularly new really, but what this camera does that's really special, and that's the point of what I'm trying to get at, you can be recording into card A in all intra 4K DCI, which is about 410 megabits per second, which is quite taxing for your computer if you were to be editing that straight off the bat. But this camera into card B can simultaneously record your proxy files. Because I know a lot of people who are shooting in high bit rates and need a fast turnaround for their edits will probably need to transcode, but if time is of the essence, you might not have the opportunity to actually do that. So you'll be suffering through slow, laggy footage. But say you've got your proxy files available for you straight away, straight off the card, straight out of the camera, you just bring both of those files, all I on one and your proxies on the other, download them into your computer, pair them up in your editing software, and then you're ready to go. Canon is aware that it's now the year 2020 and vertical video is becoming more in demand because of TikTok, because of Instagram stories, and also because of those like vertically framed advertising screens that you're seeing at bus stops or at train stations. So Canon has actually implemented some of these ideas into the Canon C70. First off, we've got a tripod mount on the side of the camera body. So you can actually mount this at a 90 degree angle, which will mean that that 16:9 resolution will then become a 9:16 resolution, I think. Is that how it works? In the menu system, just so that all the furniture and all your settings aren't like, sideways on you, you can actually go into the monitor settings of this camera and set it to 90 degrees so that you can see it how you would expect to see it. I know what I'm going to be shooting my TikToks on. As for autofocus, Canon have implemented their dual pixel CMOS autofocus functionality into this build. And this autofocus functionality also works across your higher frame rate modes. And in terms of modes for the AF, you have human face tracking, which continues tracking even after your subject turns their head away. Say you do a spin in the middle of the street and you're still recording them, that tracking will still autofocus to their head. And another feature that I really love in modern cameras is touch focusing. Thanks to the fully articulating touchscreen monitor that comes on the body of this camera, we have touch focusing, which means that we can point at one point of the frame, say something in the foreground, and say we want to rack focus to something that's in the background. All we have to do is have that in frame, touch it on the monitor screen, and then it will rack focus over to that point. Now what that does is it just saves us the hassle of having to manually focus, and say like you overshoot it by like a millimeter, it's still soft and you're likely going to have to go for a retake. And just to give you a little bit more control, in the menu settings you can set how fast that focus racking will be. So if you set it to maximum speed, it'll be like tickety-boo, really quick. And if you want to be more slow and dramatic, then you can set it down to the negatives, or even just at zero. I kind of just left it at zero because I felt that was the most natural focus pull. And that's something that the AF in this camera does really well, is that the autofocus is very natural. It feels like it's all intentional, which it is, but it's not manual. And the autofocus applies to 80% of your screen space. So that's a lot of space to maintain focus. I mean, the rest of it's really just the edge of frame, which is usually not a very natural place to focus on. Something that I thought was going to be a drawback to this camera is that it does not have IBIS. So for all you handheld shooters out there, you might be thinking, oh, maybe this isn't the camera for me. However, what it does have, it has e-stabilization, which is pretty good. What that basically means is that it crops in on the sensor a little bit and jiggles the picture around a little bit to compensate for any shake. I did have that activated for some of the handheld shots that I took throughout my test footage. And I found that when you pair it with a lens that benefits from optical stabilization, I actually found that the stabilization that I was getting was actually pretty good. And because the camera is quite big and a little bit weighty, that kind of helps compensate for any shake that your hands might naturally have. I find it's more lighter cameras that are more prone to very kind of subtle movements that cause quite a big motion in the footage. Audio. So behind your fully articulating touchscreen monitor, you just flip that aside, then you reveal all of your audio control dials. So you've got your audio leveling dials, and then you've got your phantom power switches, your line, your mic, all the usual bits and bobs that you're used to seeing on most cameras. Something that is quite weird about this camera is that it does have XLR inputs, but they're not your conventional XLR inputs. They are mini XLR inputs. And this might be quite annoying for a lot of sound professionals out there who would want to plug straight into this camera, or anyone professional actually who just has XLR based microphones. But on our store page, we do sell mini XLR to full blown XLR adapters. So I'll leave a link in the description for you so that you can find those. Something else that sound and other cameras, say it's a multi-camera shoot, can benefit from is the time in and out terminal built into the body of this camera. We also have a USB-C for data transfer, and we have plenty of assignable buttons across the body. A lot of them have been designated to certain settings already, but you can redesignate those through the menu system. For those of you who like to use external monitors or external recorders, you do have the full HDMI on the side of this body as well. We also have two 3.5mm ports on the body, one for headphones and one for a microphone. So if you're not using those mini XLR ports, then alternatively, you could use that 3.5mm port instead. It has three vents on the body, one big one for air intake, which blows lots of fresh, cool air across the hardware internally of this camera, and then two additional ports, which lets all the hot air out. So that really helps with ventilation and keeping this camera cool. You can rest assured that you can use this throughout the day. I haven't experienced any overheating, and I've shot with this quite a bit now in various situations, especially in a hot kitchen over a hot stove. I mean, it fared pretty well there, so I don't think you need to worry about overheating for the C70. Now, in terms of who this camera is for, something you've got to bear in mind is that this is a dedicated video camera, a Cinema EOS video camera. And it is portable, and it does share a certain form factor similar to the 1DX Mark III, except a little bit smaller. Keeping the form factor of this camera quite low, I think, was actually a really good move by Canon, because this is something I could certainly stow away in my just standard camera backpack, take it up to the cliffs of Snowdonia or whatever, and just make a feature documentary about, I don't know, mountain goats. Is there mountain goats over there? I don't know. I see the C70 very much as a run and gun style camera. It's small, it's lightweight, it's robust, so documentary and video journalism, news gathering, as corporate video, you name it. Like, professionally, I think this camera offers so much, and it has so many creative features built into it. The vertical video is a nice touch to that as well for those who are looking to make more vertical video based content. It has all the resolutions and picture profiles you would typically expect from a high production value camera. One of the drawbacks you could iron up is that the reason the C100 was kind of ushered in was because a lot of people who were shooting on DSLRs at the time for video looked like they were just photographers when shooting out in the field. And they wanted clients to see them as videographers. So the C100 kind of loaned that kind of aesthetic to them. And if you wanted it to look like a cinema camera, that top handle applied to the top actually does transform the appearance of this thing pretty well. And seeing all those buttons, seeing the red record button on the front of that camera and the red light that's constantly on while you're recording, I think this is a wicked build. I think this is certainly a camera that, for anyone who is looking to move into the RF lineup of lenses, then this would be a very good, almost like not an upgrade, but a transition across from, say, the C300 Mark II to the C70. It seems to be an arm race at the moment between Canon, Sony, and Panasonic, and I'm just happy to see that the C70 is actually such a workhorse powerhouse of a camera. Now, if you've got any questions about the Canon C70, then please leave a comment down below. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. Otherwise, link in the description, straight to our store page. It has loads of information on there. Now, we have loads of content on our channel and loads more content coming up. I am looking to get the C70 again, so if you're interested, please subscribe to our channel and hit that notification bell so you don't miss out on anything. And as always, thank you very much for watching. I'll see you next time.